Always a favourite on every rural road. Hyundai Country Calendar.
The soil is our biggest asset, really. Humanity relies on the fact that it rains and we've got 6 inches of topsoil. We've got to look after it.
In that soil, this family's roots run deep.
We've been here a long time. We've got an obligation to the old people because they did the best they could, so we've got to do the best we can.
Glen Eden is a South Wararapa sheep, beef and cropping farm. Annabelle and Ben are making their own fun this morning, while Dad, Mark Guscott, inspects his crop.
Oh. Hi, Dad.
Hey, yeah, the kids are hard case. They can probably do this stuff all day, running around in the crop. Oh, I'm just checking maize, counting the number of kernels that are developing. This is just pollinated. So this looks like it might be even 18 round, which indicates a bumper crop, which is pretty cool. This is my job, really, checking crops this time of year. Just checking for bugs and diseases and moisture and wondering if I need to keep irrigating.
That looks good. Happy.
There's attention to detail when cropping. You really got to check the corners of the paddocks and make sure it's all hunky-dory. There's an old saying that there's no better fertiliser than the farmer's boots. And so that's just walking, just looking. You've got to do that old-fashioned stuff, but you've also got to use the tech to have a mix of both. There's a lot of science, but there's a bit of art too, maybe.
Most of that tech comes from outside contractors.
I'm probably a little bit of a fraud as a cropping farmer, I suppose. I've got one small tractor and I do spraying and fertiliser. All the big jobs with the big gear and stuff, I sort of contract out to other people. Which is actually really good because I don't have to have $1 million plus worth of capital out and gear that depreciates quickly and get specialists to do specialist jobs. Thomas is planting squash today. That's a specialist planter, specialist large tractor. It's really easy for me. I provide all the inputs and provide the paddock for them and the way they go. And then I take over and all the husbandry that comes after that. It won't get harvested until April or May. The squash gets made into baby food and cup of soups and flavours for protein shakes.
As well as maize and squash, Mark grows oats, barley, grass seed and other crops, depending on what the market demands.
Another one of my jobs, I suppose, is finding those markets and can we grow it is the main thing, of course. Is it economically worthwhile? Is it not going to damage our soils? The soil is our biggest asset, really. I mean, obviously, really, really important to look after it. Back in the old days, they didn't have any other options. They just cultivated and thrashed the soil. Like this one here has been fully cultivated, ploughed and everything. We're probably 80% no tillage now. We're just constantly evolving to try and find ways to do things better with less inputs and less impact on the environment around us. Sue's my wife, she thinks exactly the same thing. We've got to look after it. I mean, we've been here a long time, our families. We've got an obligation to the old people because they did the best they could as well, and so we've got to do the best we can.
Morning.
Morning, how are you going?
How's it going?
Good.
Kids all gone to school?
Yeah, just heading up the hill to do a bit of cleaning.
Oh yeah, nice, yeah.
Is that Thomas out here?
Yeah, Thomas doing that squash planting, which is cool. Good to have that on the way.
There's great machines now that just do everything in one pass, so it lessens the impact of you know, vehicles going over and over the soil.
Less use of diesel, less time.
With a background in environmental planning, Mark's wife Suze is focused on the big picture.
I kind of class it as I'm the CEO, I make shit happen every day, and Suze is the chair, so she sort of has the helicopter view, I suppose.
I don't need to know all the day-to-day.
Yeah, she doesn't care what's been planted in some paddock or what fertiliser we're using or whatever like that. But then if it's a certain direction, she'll definitely pull me up and go, well, was that the right idea? Or, which is good, it's the way it should be.
The way they irrigate is a good example of that teamwork and big picture thinking.
Using variable rate irrigation has been a big game changer.
It's been a real big game changer, yeah.
Before Mark and Suze took over Glen Eden Farm in the early 2000s, it was run by Mark's parents, Phil and Joe. Phil turned the river flats into a vast circular paddock to house what was then a state-of-the-art centre pivot irrigator.
He was one of the first handful in the Wairarapa to do it. Massively increased the production at the time, but there wasn't really any thought, not just him, across the board, about using resources wisely.
When Mark and Suze took over, they upgraded from a uniform irrigator to the variable rate model.
Straight away, we used 20% less water.
Every inch of the soil in the river flats was analysed and mapped and compared to crop yield data.
Every one of the nozzles will turn on and off individually as told by a software program, which I run out of the computer in the office. And so that is all calibrated with the soil type. So the light soil gets more water and the heavy bits of the soil get less. The irrigation has changed the way the whole farm is run now. It's not just about the 150 hectares of irrigated land, it's about the other 800 odd that are on the hills.
While the crops grow on the fertile flats, the Guscott's Hill country is best suited to grazing for the sheep and beef side of the operation.
Globally, there's a bit of a push towards a lot more plant-based eating. We believe there's always going to be a market for high-quality lamb. There's always going to be people wanting to buy that and not necessarily wanting to have a lamb patty or sausage made out of something else.
Yeah, something from a factory. Yeah, you need flexibility in a farming system. Diversity is everything for us.
Wairarapa cropping farmers Mark and Suze Guscott grow corn for chook feed, but they also grow it for seed.
This is not a common crop of maize to grow or sweet corn. Most of the stuff that you see around the place is for human consumption.
This variety is not for human or animal consumption just yet.
We're growing seed which grows into food, so we're kind of creating food next year for someone else to grow the food.
But not all maize seed growers do it this way. This maize is being detasseled.
This process of detasseling and growing seed maize and seed sweet corn is not conventional. It's a bit more specialised. You need some specialist gear and expertise and facilities to do this sort of thing. Taking the male flower out of the top of the plant like that, chucking it on the ground. We're just crossbreeding two different varieties, creating the high quality product, which is effectively what nature's doing over thousands of years. Yeah, plant sex. It's a pretty in-depth and risky sort of crop to grow. A lot of labour required. It's a high risk crop, but it's quite a good return if it goes well. The sheep and beef stuff's relatively low risk compared to this, but relatively low return. This crop pretty much just sits and grows now till May and the seed matures and gets to a certain point before harvest. But there's other crops on the farm, like we've got barley over the front that we're going to harvest later on today. Today's harvest day, which is the most important day, really.
Hey, mate, how you going?
Yeah, good, good.
Good yield, I hear.
Oh, just over 8, it should finish up. So.
Yeah, awesome. I'll keep it right, eh?
When the crop basically dies off and dries down, we do a bit of basic moisture testing. Hey, Mac, how you going?
Good, buddy.
Going all right?
Yeah.
Yield seems pretty good. The moisture's got to be under 14.5% to go to commercial storage. And it was about 12, 12.5% or something, so perfect. Yeah, and then we cut it off and put it on the truck and away she goes. The yield looks really good, so I'm wrapped. Yeah, it's a great day. This barley's basically being sold to a merchant, and so they'll sell it to probably a dairy farmer or a chook farmer or a pig farmer, something like that. It goes into animal feed.
But the animal feed won't be used here at Glen Eden. The Guscott stock are exclusively grass-fed.
We sell all of our lamb to Atkins Ranch, which supplies the whole food supermarkets in the States, mainly in California. Atkins Ranch lambs, they all have to be antibiotic-free, 100% grass-fed. That's a biggie, especially in the States, because they have a lot of grain feeding over there. So one of the things they love about New Zealand lamb is the fact that it's just 100% out in the open, eating grass.
Some of the sheep need a little help until they're ready for that grass-only diet.
One of the best things I think about growing up on a farm, I used to love it when I was a kid, feeding lambs. I still remember the names of a couple of them, Pebbles and Lucky.
The lamb distribution company, Atkins Ranch, was started in the 1980s by Mark's dad, Phil.
I had the view that we should be designing lambs to go to a specific market, so that if you knew where they were going to, you'd design the lambs that they wanted.
It's high animal welfare standards. We don't feed grain of any shape or form. We don't go through sale yards. You have to have minimum trucking distances.
No antibiotics, it's got no feed additives. It's naturally reared, it's grass-fed.
The welfare standards are, to be quite honest, they're what 99% of New Zealand farmers do anyway. We just market it better, I reckon. I can't understand why people don't produce what people want. We aim to produce 20-21 kilo carcass lambs every month of the year.
Yeah,
it's a good day. Every day's a good day, but especially when you're getting paid, I suppose. The prices are particularly good at the moment too, so it's quite nice. There's a whole range of reasons, but you know, we've had some nice rain, which helps get these lambs nice and prime and makes them looking good.
Like the sheep, Susan Mark's cattle are marketed and distributed under high quality and welfare standards.
Buddy's in the, you know, the pet from last year?
Yeah.
He's in this mob.
Is Buddy in it?
Yeah, he's in this mob we're going to bring down shortly. Won't stop for a yarn though, because he's not that friendly. But our beef business is called First Light Wagyu, and that's destined for sort of high value markets in the States, normally. But it's exactly the same rationale and thinking that Atkins Ranch Lamb has, and that's called certified humane. Certified humane means we're not actually out to create mud. So I graze them out at the neighbours for the winter, and then they come back to us and just before calving.
Hello, good girl.
Diversity is everything for us. Diversity and flexibility, really.
Please,
you've just always got to have your finger on the pulse of grass measurements and grass growth and stock values, ups and downs. I liken it to having a jigsaw. And you make your jigsaw, and then every couple of months you throw the jigsaw in the air and you've got to start again and remake it. It's a bit challenging at times, but that's farming, you know, it's cool.
Good girl, Kel.
Oh, it'll be good to get it done.
Do that other block on the other side of the lane there too, eh?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Three generations ago, the 600-hectare Glendower farm in South Wairarapa was split into two smaller farms. Mark Guscott's father, Phil, took over one of those portions, Glen Eden, in the 1970s.
I made up my mind when I was only about probably 18 or 19 that really there wasn't a living in it for me and there was no future for any of my kids, if I had any. So I took nothing out of the farm at all and I pushed whatever money I could back in to pay the mortgage down. Until in 1999, my cousin said to me one day, did I want to buy his two-thirds? So I big borrowed and stole from the bank and anybody else where I could, and we did. And so that's how we got it back together again.
But running Atkins Ranch left Phil little time for a farm that needed major redevelopment work. He offered Glen Eden to Mark and Suze.
It was pretty tough for them, for him especially. Having to give it up,
It's one of the hardest things to do as a father and as a farmer, because I was only 55 at the time, and I really enjoyed my farming.
He felt like he had his arm cut off. It's pretty tough.
Oh, I missed the farm. Still do. But I was sitting up in bed one morning, or about 3 months after we'd actually done the transaction, I was feeling all grumpy. And my wife said to me, "What's wrong with you?" And I said, "I'm grumpy because I swore I'd never sell the farm." And she said, "But you sold it to the only person in the world you would." And that was absolutely right. I've not regretted it from that moment. Not once.
What's good? You won't like it.
It's been the best thing we ever did. The farm's gone ahead ever since. It's been a good move for us, and it's been really good for the family. And the best thing for me was it gave me the opportunity to give Mark an opportunity, because that's what I dreamt of when I was about 18.
Mark and Phil's tepuna have been on this land for hundreds of years.
I don't really know who the guy on the waka was, so I don't know who was first, but in terms of from a Pākehā measurement, if our kids want to farm, they'll be the seventh generation. But when Europeans say it's seven generations, it's not recognising what happened before that, which is not right. John Milsom Jury, he's buried on the hill over here. So he arrived in
1854,
yeah. The old Walshwood was built in 1868. Te Atu o Te Rangi. Yeah, she was my great-great-great-great-grandmother, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you remember the story of Pākehā ancestor and how he met Te Aite? Do you remember that story?
Yeah, kind of.
Kind of? Well, that's... She was over on Kapiti Island, and she'd been captured by Te Rauparaha.
She was the daughter of a local chief, and Te Rauparaha...
Te Rauparaha killed
her father.
Te Aite's father and captured her and took her to Kapiti Island,
yep,
where she was enslaved.
John Jury turned up on Kapiti Island, and they decided that they liked one another. so they stole a boat from Te Rauparaha, which was a pretty hard thing to do. And then they paddled from Kapiti Island with Te Rauparaha in hot pursuit.
They didn't even stop once.
With wind chasing you wouldn't. Te Rauparaha couldn't find them, and he finally got tired of it and went home. Then they could get married. Yeah. So that's kind of the story about how the old boy first got here and how he and Te Aite got together and started everything.
Cool.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Much of the land was still in bush back then, and one far-sighted ancestor chose to preserve 18 hectares of it.
Mark's great-grandparents decided it would be really nice to hold on to some native bush so that future generations could see what the bush looked like in this area. So we protected it with Kiwi Tū Trust about 15 years ago. It's been fantastic watching it all regenerate around us, and we're actively catching possums and killing rats and doing a bit of pest weed control as well.
Nope.
Oh, dang it.
The kids really enjoy coming through and have great time, like yelling out when they find a possum to trap. We use possum pindon, and we use apple, which is covered in cinnamon, because possums are attracted to the smell of that. The kids usually run ahead and yell out, "There's a possum!" And we all come very excitedly, and I put my gloves on because I hate touching possums.
At the top of the covenanted bush, Suze and Mark have built an off-grid retreat for guests, with views over Martinborough and the Ruamahanga River.
Mark and I, we're really keen to have a diverse and adaptable business, and part of that diversification has been to build Whirimanuka Retreat. So we're up here today just getting the place ready for my parents, who are actually coming to stay for the first time. They've never seen it finished, so it's going to be pretty exciting to see their reactions. This land is incredibly important to Mark and I, and to the five generations that came before us. So we're really lucky that Olive Jury took the time to write that family history down for us. And one of the things she actually writes in the book is, to all future generations, follow the footsteps of your ancestors and your lives will prove worthwhile, she says, and to value highly the soil and to carry on. So that's exactly what we've all been doing since then. We've been carrying on, and every generation has made their own changes to this business and the land.
Hi, Granny.
Oh, yeah. Good day.
How are you?
Mark and Sue's plant a tree for every booking at Whitimānuka. Planting trees is their thing. With their neighbours, they've formed the Ponatahi ecozone.
We work together to do environmental stuff, like planting out wetlands and doing riparian planting. We believe that nature doesn't have boundaries, so it makes sense to work as a whole catchment.
The ecozone Hawhia is a community thing as well, rather than just about ecology. We're all part of the ecology too around here. Most people, well, not just farmers, get a kick out of planting trees because you know it'll be something that'll be still be there after you're gone. So that's pretty cool. And I think all the old people that have been on our land before us, they've preserved bush. Mum and Dad had it real tough for a few years. They were only a year away from selling the farm. So I know how hard I know how hard they've worked. So it's quite important for us to do the right for them too. So, it's pretty important, I think.
Yeah, you push the brakes and you draw. Well, you learn all that stuff quite quickly.
Calendar was brought to you by Hyundai New Zealand.